This is Eteta from Morogoro. My name is Newa William Kimo, your English teacher. Today we are going to share the topic about reading literary works. The subtopics are identifying and analyzing setting, main plot, and characters. The second subtopic is identifying the themes and discuss them. That is the semantic analysis. At the end of the lesson, I expect that you as a student, you should be able to describe the characters, themes, setting, and plot of the literary work. The book that we are going to read today is called, titled, Unanswered Cries. That is the book that we are going to pass through. We are going to analyze it. And to start with, we are going to have at least a brief summary of the book and answer the class, so that you can have at least a skeleton, or you can have a love picture of the book itself. It's a novel, and answer the class. It's a very interesting novel, and I'm sure you're going to enjoy it. The author of this novel is known as Osman Conte. And the setting of this book is in Freetown, in Sierra Leone, west part of Africa. And the publisher at the Macmillan, and the book was published in 2002. So we are going to start with the general summary of the book, as how I've said. The book and answer the class, or the novel, let me use the word novel, the novel and answer the class starts by showing The main character in this novel is Orabis, a town girl from Freetown, being in her mother's village. As you know, my dear students, always when you have the holiday, you always go back to your parents. If they live in the village, you can move all the way from Dar es Salaam, from Mwanza, Tabora, and some other places, and you can go to the village to have at least a holiday with your parents. So our character Orabis is in the rural area, or is in the village, having gone there to visit her mother. The writer introduces the Bondo secret group passing the village, dancing, and it is being read by their leader Jia Pose. That is another character in our novel, Jia Pose, who is the Digba Sowe, means the leader of all the circumcisers in the village. You know, we are talking about a traditional village, a village which sticks in the traditional ways. That is, they believe, they are the followers, or, they believe in African culture, the African traditions and customs. And you have to take note that Orabis is from the city, so she really doesn't know most of these things. So she's very new to some of the African traditions and customs. We are going to see it later. So the writer introduces the Bondo secret group, which is the secret group found in the village, and they normally deal with circumcision of women, circumcision of girls. The writer introduces the Bondo secret group passing the village dancing, and the reader, who is indicated here, Jia Pose. This is the reader, or the is the very notable woman in the village, and everyone is afraid of her because she's said to be a wizard or a sorcerer. Orabis gets interested to go out and watch the Bondo dancers, but her mother seems to be reluctant to her to go out to watch them, since she's not circumcised. Because according to the people in this village, they believe that all girls are supposed to be circumcised. If you are not circumcised, you are not a real woman. Those who are not circumcised are regarded as borka. It's a word used in Sierra Leone to mean someone who is not circumcised. someone who is not circumcised. So the uncircumcised girls are not allowed even to go close to the circumcised girls. Those who were circumcised could not interact or mix with those who were not circumcised. And as you know, Orabis is from the city and she doesn't know some of these customs and traditions, and therefore she's not circumcised. And according to traditions, she's not allowed to go close to those girls who are dancing, and most of them are circumcised. And this is a traditional village in Sierra Leone, the real traditional village in Sierra Leone. These are the pictures reflecting people in Sierra Leone. We have, you know, our character Orabis is young, a young girl, the age of 14. So she resembles a little bit this girl here. And this is her mother, Makre, her mother. And up there we can see the village, a traditional village in Sierra Leone. That is the environment of Sierra Leone. You can see the houses, you know, this is grass thatched houses, and the villages out there. So we can put imagination of a village where Orabis was living, where she went for holiday to visit her mother and also stayed the holiday over there. And this is a Bondo traditional dance. You can see it. We have yapose, indicated in raffia cloth, frightening type of clothes that can make someone to run away. You know, the dancers can be seen out there. I think you can see the picture clearly. They are dancing. Actually, you have men as well as women. They're there. Though the function is really particularly for women. That's why they call it the Bondo Women Secret Group. But you can have also some of the people watching the traditional dance, just the same as how Orabis also wanted to go and watch. So that is, when you talk of the raffia cloth show indicated in this novel, An Answer Declines, the raffia cloth looks like that. It looks like, you know, the garments which are frightening garments, like that one which can be shown. Makre is Orabis's mother. Makre is Orabis's mother, who is a primary school teacher and lives in the village. So Makre, Orabis's mother, wants her not to go close to Bondo dancers since she is a Bolka. She is an uncircumcised girl. She doesn't deserve to go close to the girls who are already circumcised. She has no right to interact with them. She has no right even to go and take pictures close. It was against the traditions and customs of the Temni people, the tribe found in Sierra Leone. So Orabis takes camera from her bag and scampers out for the purpose of taking some pictures, pictures of the Bondo dancers who are dancing over there. But as I said before, her mother was really reluctant because she knew the traditions could not let her go close and watch or take pictures of those Bondo sacred dancers. But she manages to take the camera, and she went to take some pictures of the dancers. When the Bondo dancers disappears, Orabis starts back with so many questions to ask her mother. As you remember, Orabis was prohibited that she should not go close, but she didn't find a reason why she should be prohibited to go close to those dancers, because according to Orabis, she thought it was just a normal dance. She didn't know the background of that traditional dance. She didn't know. As I said before, she was ignorant of the African traditions and customs. She didn't know anything because she was raised up in the city. So she comes back with a lot of questions, and one of the questions was, what does it mean by Bolka? It was a vocabulary to her, and therefore she wanted to be given the meaning of Bolka by her mother, Makre, a traditionalist, educated woman, but still upholds the African traditions, Makre. So the word Bolka was very new to Orabis's ears. When she asked her mother the meaning of the word, her mother says, a Bolka is a girl who is not circumcised. a girl who is not circumcised in Sierra Leone, among the Temni people, the tribe found in Sierra Leone, are known as Gibolka, uncircumcised girl. So Margaret tells her daughter that one day she can be a member of the Bondo sacred group, if she gets circumcised. So you become a member of the Bondo sacred group if you are circumcised. If you are not circumcised, you cannot be the member of the Bondo sacred group. So Orabis is not circumcised. For her to be a member of Bondo sacred group, therefore, she is to be circumcised. But as I said before, Orabis knows nothing about the traditions and customs of the Temni people, because she was raised in the city and she really doesn't even support the issue of circumcision. We're going to see it later. So Makari tells her daughter that a real woman, according to the Temni people, a real woman is the one who bears the pain of circumcision or mutilation. So for someone who can bear the pain of mutilation or the pain of circumcision, that is a real woman, according to the Temni people. It means anyone who is not circumcised, regardless of her age, whether you are old, with gray hair, if you are not circumcised, you are just regarded like a girl. You cannot be called a woman in the Temni society, among the people. So a circumcised one will be regarded a woman, even if she's very young. Even at the age of 10, 11 or 12 years, she's a woman, as far as she's circumcised. But an uncircumcised one, even if you are very old, you remain to be called a Gibolka. A Gibolka is just like an insult for those who are not circumcised. And actually, this kind of people who are not circumcised among the Temni people are despised. And that's why they cannot even be allowed to go close to the circumcised girls. They cannot interact, they cannot do anything with those ones who regard themselves to be circumcised. So a real woman is the one who can bear, someone who can be able to bear the pain of circumcision. If you can bear the pain of circumcision, then you are a woman. Orabis' interpretation of a real woman is different. Orabis' interpretation of a real woman is very different. To her, a real woman is the one who can bear the pain of being beaten. Very funny. Or fight against invaders. If you can be able to fight against people, you can be able to bear the pain. Even if someone slaps you and then you bear the pain, then you are a woman, according to Orabis' interpretation. Orabis rejects her mother's idea of being circumcised or mutilated, in spite of being promised a lot of promises. You know, those who get circumcised, they are normally promised a lot of gifts. For example, very attractive and expensive clothes are given to those who are ready to be circumcised. If you get circumcised, then you are going to get a lot of gifts or presents. There are the gifts of expensive clothes, the gifts of gold rings, the trinkets, and other things of alike. So if you want to get them, you cannot get them if you're not circumcised. You have to bear the pain of mutilation. You have to bear the pain of circumcision. But Orabis is against this practice, and she's not ready for that. Even when she's promised that she's going to be given, you know, precious, expensive clothes, earrings, the trinkets, and others of her like, but yet she's not ready to go for circumcision. She's totally against it. She's totally against it. And therefore she goes against the interests of her mother. Now, we have another scene starting at the well. At the well, in the village, we all know that there are no tap water. Though at the moment, in some parts of Africa, even here in Tanzania, most of women go to the well to fetch water. If there are no taps, then you have to go to fetch water at the well. And actually, at the well, you can have so many people coming to fetch water. And it is also a place of gossiping. People can be speaking this and that while taking water from the well. So at the well, when Orabis goes to the well, because in Freetown, which is a city, a very big city in Sierra Leone, there are taps, and therefore you just get gushing water just in the house. You don't have to go to the well. After all, maybe even the wells are not there. They can just be found in a village, like the village where Orabis visited. So when Orabis goes to the well, she meets two village girls. The first one is known as Rugiatu, and the other villager known as Sare. These are Yapose's daughters. You remember Yapose? Yapose is the leader of the circumcises, known as Edigbasowe. And these are her daughters, Rugiatu and Sare. They are traditional village women. Why am I saying women? Because they are already circumcised. They are really at the age of Orabis, but different from Orabis because she's not circumcised, because she's a Dibona. They are women. They are regarded as women. So Riyat and Saleh are women regardless of their age because they are circumcised. Now when Orabis went to the well, she met them. And as I told you before, the circumcised girls were not allowed to interact with those ones who were not circumcised. They could not, you know, cooperate in anything. So there was a sort of isolation. So Rabis wonders on how the girls can care, or they can balance the buckets full of water on their heads. She's not used to that. She's not used to carry a bucket in Freetown because there are taps there. So you just get water in the house. You don't have to go to the well to fetch water. So the practice of balancing the bucket on the head really interested the Orabis, and she kept on watching on how they could walk without holding the bucket, just walking majestically without putting their hands on the bucket. To Orabis, it was a new experience. She didn't really managed to do so because she tried to balance the bucket without holding her hands on the bucket. She fell. All the water spilled on the floor. So Orabis wonders how the girl can balance the bucket full of water on their heads. She's not used to carry a bucket of water on the head back in Freetown, in the city of Freetown. So Orabis gets interested to ask them some few questions. You know, Orabis was new in the village. She was a guest, and therefore she thought that she could just interact with anyone. She didn't know that there was limitation, that she was not allowed to do some of the things, like talking to the girls or to these women now, because they are no longer girls because they are circumcised. She's not allowed to talk to women. It's very funny. So Orabis gets interested to ask them some few questions. She started by calling them, "Hey girls," that was mistake number one. And then she asked them the question, "Hey, are you Iboka? Hey, are you Iboka?" That is mistake number two. Telling them that they are girls while they are circumcised, it was a grave mistake. And telling them that they are Diboka while they are already circumcised, I don't know how can I put it, it was also a grave mistake. To them, it was a very big insult. To them, it was an insult that could make them attack you frantically. It was a very big mistake that could not be tolerated. And therefore, they reacted. They reacted against Orabis for calling them girls and for calling them Iboka, while themselves they knew that they were women and they were circumcised. So the term Iboka was honorary to remain to those who were not circumcised. So when they became angry for being called girls and Iboka, or a miss try to explain, you know, guys, you should not be, you should not panic. The forecast is just a word like any other word. It's just like pineapple, it's just like, you know, a hoe or anything that you can mention. It has nothing to do. You know, it's just a word. Why are you upset to that extent? You want to fight with me? Actually, things fall apart. That is the picture showing the girls at the well, as I said. And on the right hand side, we have the girls carrying the bucket. Actually, you can see they don't put their hands on the buckets, they can just walk majestically. And that is a traditional way of carrying the bucket. In African traditions, they have their ways of carrying the bucket of water. To Arabis, it was really an examination to her. She could not do it. She could not. She could not balance the bucket full of water on the head. So those are just some pictures to show what does it mean when we talk about the well. Lugyanka and Saleh, after being called that they are girls instead of being called women, and after being named that they are Jiborka, because Arabis didn't know really the impact of mentioning the word Jiborka. She didn't know. She just knew that it was just a word like another word. So Rugyab and Saleh reacted vigorously against Arabis like potassium in cold water when she called them girls and asked them whether they were Jiborka. So a fight started between Rugiatu, Saleh, and Arabis on the other side. So Rugiatu and Saleh attacked Arabis like frantic dogs, but they were no match to her. I'll tell you something why they were no match to her. She kicks Rugiatu on the stomach and falls down like a sack of maize. You know, back in Freetown, Arabis was trained by her boyfriend. Can I say boy lover? Because there is a difference between boyfriend and boy lover. These are two different terms. So, Arabis was trained on how to lose the carrot. That is, she was trained how to defend herself against enemies by using the skills of carrot. And therefore, it was very easy to overpower or to beat these village girls or village women, as how they call themselves. Because she had all the techniques of fighting and defending herself. So Lugyanka and Saleh, after attacking Arabis, they were beaten like nobody's business. So Lugyanka was kicked on the stomach and fell down like a sack of maize. And what happened later? Arabis stripped Lugyanka naked and then jerks her bits around the waist and tries to split Lugyanka's legs to see what is in between legs. Eh? That is circumcised. That makes them different from other uncircumcised girls. That was mistake number three. Mistake number four. Fighting against women while you are a girl, and then you want to see what is in between their legs. That is circumcised, which is different from other girls. It was a grave mistake. Had it that Arabis knew what she was doing, she could not really think of doing so. It was really against the customs and traditions among the Temni people. A girl fighting women, a girl who is not circumcised, wants to see what is circumcised between the legs. It was a very big mistake, very big mistake. So before Arabis manages to do so, Saleh hits her with a heavy object on her head and collapses. And what happened when Arabis collapsed? Lugyanka and Saleh went back home and they reported what happened to their mother, Yapose, the most feared woman among the Temni people, because they were afraid of her. She could spell a curse on you. She was a wizard, a sorcerer, feared by people. So to Arabis, she didn't know. She didn't know that. So she took things lightly, for granted. So Rugiatu and Saleh reported to their mother, Yapose, they fight between them and Orabis and how Orabis misbehaved before them. First of all, by calling them girls. Secondly, by calling them Iboka. Third, by fighting them, and even worse, when she wanted to peep to see what is in between their legs, that is circumcised, which makes them different from other girls. It was really very funny and ridiculous. So the Bono secret group led by Yabose invaded Macrae's home and ordered her to send her daughter for circumcision as a punishment for misbehaving towards circumcised girls who should be respected as women. So the punishment for Oramis was now to be sent for circumcision by force. Whether she likes or not, she had to go for circumcision as a punishment for what she did. And that was the order from the most feared woman among the Temne people, Yabose. And as you know, Macrae was the upholder of African customs and traditions, and she respected people like Yabose and others, the traditionalists, because she was a traditionalist too, regardless of her level of education. And therefore, she could not oppose the order from Yabose, the Digbasogi, the leader of the Bondo secret group. And therefore, there was no way for Oramis, and the only way was Honori to agree that she's ready to be circumcised. But Oramis was not ready. So the Bondo secret group led by Yabose invaded the house and gave that order. Orabis hears the order from Yabose because she was inside. She was in the house and she knew everything going on. So she knew what was going to happen. Orabis hears the orders from Yabose and wonders to hear her mother accepting the orders from the Digbasogi. Yabose, the most feared woman among the Temne people, as I told you before. So her mother could not oppose the order from Yabose because she respected the customs. She respected the traditionalists, and she was the upholder of the African customs and traditions, regardless of whether they are outdated or whatever. What she knew is that everyone had to respect the African customs and traditions. And therefore, respecting the order from Yabose was not strange to her. It was just common, and after all, she wanted her daughter to get mutilated or circumcised. So Orabis manages to escape from the house using the back door and disappears in the forest. When she heard the arrangement of Yabose and the argument of her mother that she should be circumcised or mutilated, Orabis decided to run away. She decided to escape. And actually, she ran into the bush or in the jungle. So Orabis managed to escape from the house using the back door and disappeared into the forest. When in the jungle, Orabis gets a lot of frightening things. She was frightened with her feet echoes when she was running, and she saw that maybe there was a beast which was running or chasing her. She was very afraid. You know, it's just common when you go to the forest, you can be frightened with only very small things, you know. Sometimes even your shadow can make you be afraid because you're just alone in the jungle. And as you know, Orabis was not used to the jungle because she was brought up in the city. And therefore, it was her first time to be in the jungle. And as a human being, it's obvious that she would be afraid. And being a young girl, at the age of 14, being in a thick jungle, it's not an easy task. It's not something which is very common, it's unusual. So Orabis hears footsteps and hides on the top of a tree. She sees women passing with small girls and remembers the Bondo secret group. I think you remember the traditional dance in the village. The dancers, the Bondo secret group had their camp in the forest, in the jungle. And it's very unfortunate that our character Orabis ran into the forest. While the center or the cave of the circumcisers is also located in the jungle. So anything can happen to her. So, and that is the image of Iyapose. She said to be, a frightening woman. Frightening woman. So I've just taken the image of Iyapose to be like that. Frightening woman. Having, you know, eyes like that of a cobra, missing some teeth, and wearing in a traditional way. Yeah. So this picture can reflect, at least we can have the image of who Iyapose is. We can have the image of who Iyapose is. And one among the girls who were escorted by women circumcised in the forest now escaped and ran away as her legs could carry her. One of those who were brought in the forest, I think it was for the circumcision or for mutilation purpose, one of the girls who was at the age of 12, can you imagine? At the age of 12, escaped. She ran away from the hands of the circumcisers. And it was not easy for her to run away and then be left to run away without being trapped. So, unfortunately, she was trapped by two giant women among the circumcisers. That small girl, at the age of 12 years old, shrieked. But there was no help in the forest. There was no help. No one could help her. Because over there, there were the circumcisers in the jungle. And Oradisu was not seen, by the way. They didn't take note of her. They didn't know that Oradisu was there in the jungle. And therefore, when the girl was shrieking, crying with pain, there was no response from anyone. There was no response. Her cry went unanswered. Her cry went unanswered. No one came for her. Hence, the title, Unanswered Cries. The cries of many women, cries of girls in the society are unanswered. We can just think of the communities where girls are being circumcised or mutilated. The government has been opposing this practice, but it is still going on. Even in Tanzania, we have some parts of Tanzania where women mutilation, female genital mutilation is being conducted. And the Digba Sowe, like the Iyapose, have been prohibited that they should not keep on, but they still keep on doing that because it's a source of income to some of the tribes. And that small girl of 12 years old kept on crying, weeping, shrieking with pain, but there was no response from anyone. And therefore, her cry was nothing to them. Her cry went unanswered. They just kept on circumcising her. So Rabis witnessed the girl being circumcised without her will. It was without her will because she was not ready to be circumcised. She was forced to be circumcised, but that was not her will. So Rabis shed tears and later realized that she was crying when she tasted tears at the corner of the mouth. It was really very sad. She didn't like that behavior. She didn't like that practice. She was hiding somewhere, witnessing everything going on. And on top of that, she was also among the wanted girls to be circumcised. She had also to be circumcised. And then now she's witnessing that little girl at the age of 12 years old, being circumcised. Though she is hiding, but she can see what was going on. So the cries of the girl went unanswered. Oradis shed tears, and she just realized that she was crying when she tasted the tears on the, you know, at the corner of the mouth, right here. When she tasted the tears, she knew that she was crying. Why Oradis was crying? She cried because she had that pinchy. Why should they do this to young girls like this one? She had that pinchy. Why do they do this without the will of someone? She had pinchy. Why should a woman, a girl, be mutilated? Therefore, she was really sad to the extent that she had to shed tears, the tears of pain. And that, my dear students, you can see the picture of a girl who is being mutilated, female genital mutilation or circumcision of women. You can see the girl up there You can see the bond, the women's alumni. I can call them the Bondo secret group right there, and that can be maybe that girl. I've just used this image so that you can have at least a picture of how circumcision is being conducted. So there is a girl lying on the ground, and the circumciser is right there, and the girl has split the legs, and there is something going on between the legs. I hope you understand. Okay, good. So we proceed on. When Orabis drops down from the tree, because all this time Orabis was not seen by the Bondo secret group. She was hiding somewhere at the top of the tree. So when she decided now to drop and continues the journey, because she didn't want to see anymore because of that pain she felt, and because of the suffering that girl faced, and the unanswered cries of the girl, she didn't want to stay there. So she wanted to proceed on with the journey. Therefore, she dropped down so that she can proceed with the journey. So when Orabis dropped down from the tree to continue her journey, she wanted us to see Yapose, Lubiate, and Sarai in front of her. Yapose is the leader of the Bondo secret group. Lubiate and Sarai, these are the enemies. Orabis' enemies, they fought at the well. I think you still remember that they fought at the well, and therefore they developed some sort of enmity. So the two enemies are there. Yapose is there. There is Rubiat and Saleh, the enemies of Orabis. What will happen? The first fight, Orabis was the winner. I hope was the winner, because she managed to fight with two girls. And actually, it's only that she was hit by that heavy object and she collapsed. But I can say she was the winner. And let's now have a look. Is she going to be a winner this time? Yapose tells her, "Welcome to the Bondo Camp, white girl." Orabis remained speechless. And she tried to remember what her mother, Makrey, told her, that Yapose is a very, very powerful man. Very, very powerful. She can spell a curse on you. She's a wizard. She's a sorcerer. She can do anything to you. So when she started calling back, remembering what her mother had told her, she was really afraid. And she didn't know what to do. But as I told you before, you know, when you are trained in karate, judo, and some other skills, you can just know how to tackle the situation. And therefore, Orabis started thinking about what to do so that she can escape from the hands of her enemies. And why did Yapose tell her, white girl? Why? Can you think about it, my dear students? Why did she say, welcome to the Bondo Camp, white girl? Was Orabis white? No. The concept of Yapose is that Orabis didn't want to be circumcised. And therefore, Yapose is trying to link Orabis with the white girls, that is the Europeans, or people who don't know the African traditions and customs. That is people who don't uphold the African customs and traditions. So it's just like an outcast is neither African nor European. So using the techniques of karate, she was trained by her boyfriend Eddie in Freetown. Orabis fights Rugiat and Saleh. For the second time, Rugiat fights the two girls, Rugiat and Saleh. They are not really girls according to Temi people, they are women. Though they have the same age like Orabis. So when she defeats them, she moves towards Yapose and shouts, "You are next." You know what happened to Yapose? She was very afraid. Why Yapose was afraid? First, she didn't expect a girl like Orabis to threaten her. She was very feared by people among the Temi people. Very feared. because of using juju. How comes a girl like Orabis threatening her? It was really, really unbelievable. She could not believe her eyes. She could not believe it. And you know what happened? She collapsed. When Orabis said, "You are next," she collapsed. So that was the time now for Orabis to escape and continue with Sadiana. By the time when Yabose collapsed, Rugiato and Saleh were doubling on the ground with Spain, because Orabis was a different girl, not the same like them. So back home, Macrae tells her husband Dauda to look for Orabis in the jungle. Dauda refuses to do so, as he is afraid of Adejones. Adejones is Orabis's father. Adejones is Orabis's father, who lives in Freetown, in the city. And he's not a Temni by tribe, he is a Creole. So the Creole does not believe in women circumcision, female genital mutilation. They don't believe in that. While the Temni people believe in circumcision. So Dauda was afraid that if I involve myself in this affair, in this issue, and according to the Creole people, they are very fast to hire lawyers and they can send you to the court. So Dauda was very afraid of being accused in the court of law. And therefore, he decided to leave all this in the hands of Macrae. And actually, it was a good decision, because this was not his case, and therefore he could not interfere the case that he didn't know. So Macrae decided to comb the bush alone, looking for Orabis in the jungle. Fortunately, she collided with a famous hunter among the Temni people, who was known as Pa Amadu, hunting in the bush. So Macrae explains to him about her daughter Orabis, who escaped from home and ran into the bush. Pa Amadu admits that he knows the girl since she has the Temni name. It was very easy for Pa Amadu to know the girl because she was new in the village and she came to be known very easily by people because of the name. You know, she had a traditional name, Orabis, which is a traditional Temni name. It's among the famous names in Sierra Leone, among the Temni people, Orabis. And therefore, Pa Amadu knew the whereabouts of the girl. He said, "Yes, I know her. So Pa Amadu admits that he knows the girl since he has the Temni name. Macrae gives Pa Amadu a task to look for the girl in the bush and promises him a gift of a goat and palm wine. You know, in West Africa, palm wine is a very common thing. You know, it's a traditional drink, you know. Anything which is done, palm wine should be there. For those who have ever read the book Things for Flora Party, it's no longer used at the moment. Palm wine is also explained in that book, in that novel. So Macrae gives Pa Amadu a task to look for Orabis in the bush and promises him a gift of a goat and palm wine if he manages to bring back the girl. That was the promise from Macrae. So instead of hunting for animals, instead of hunting for the wild animals in the bush, Macrae was ready to give Pa Amadu a goat. Instead of keeping on hunting the wild animals in the bush, Macrae was ready to give a goat to Pa Amadu so that he can look for Orabis in the bush. And actually, Pa Amadu could not turn off the offer. He decided to start the work of searching for Orabis. So he started combing the bush or the jungle. And actually, it was not difficult for him to locate Orabis in the bush because he was an experienced hunter and he knew every corner of the bush, of the jungle. So being an experienced hunter who knows the jungle, Pa Amadu manages to find the girl. And what happened after finding the girl? Orabis bribes the hunter per amadu by giving him the amount of money enough to buy two goats. Hence, he decided to let her go. So instead of one goat now, that was promised by Makri, Oramis doubles the gift. That if you let me go, I'm going to give you two goats. So Pa'amadu could not let that offer. Pa'amadu could not go and look for one goat while Oramis here promises two goats. Just letting her go away. Two goats. So Pa'amadu decided to let the girl continue with that journey. And I think he also showed her the way that if you want to get out of this jungle, you have to pass this way, and then you get the tarmac road, you can proceed on with your journey. Two goats. He could not leave that gift. So while in the forest now, Oramis faced a lot of challenges. As you know, in the forest, there are a lot of wild animals. And being her first time to be in the forest, because she had no experience of walking the forest, crossing the jungle, it was her first time because she was not used to such a situation. She was not used to, you know, walking in the bushes or in the jungle. So Oramis had to face a lot of challenges for the first time. And according to her, she regarded to be a real woman. Because, as I said before, Oramis had a very different interpretation of a real woman. According to Oramis, even passing through the forest without being afraid, that also makes you to be a real woman, according to her. So she was almost eaten by the crocodile when crossing the river, but she managed to escape. It was really an adventure. It was just like an adventure. So back in Freetown, in the city now, we go back in the city. Oramis arrives in Freetown safely. We are not told which transport she used to travel from when she located the road to Freetown, but we only told that she arrives in Freetown safely. Her stepmother, Oya, one of the other characters who lived with her father, and her father, Ali Jonas, welcomes her happily, says, "You're welcome, my daughter." When she narrates the story of what happened to her in the mother's village and in the forest, Jonas becomes very angry. And he told his daughter, that I will not let you go back to your mom. I will not let you go back to your mother because she forced you to get circumcised, which is against our tradition. According to the theory, circumcision of women is not allowed. They don't have female genital mutilation. It's only among the Temne people. So Jonas, as a father, was really, had that pinch. Why should this be done to my daughter? Why did she decide to do that? Why did Makri decide to circumcise the girl without my consent? So such kind of questions, and it really caused him to lose temper, and that's why he was very sad when he heard the story about what happened in the village, but also the danger that could. That Oramis could face in the forest, running away or escaping from the Bondo secret group who wanted to circumcise her. So anything could happen. So in Freetown, this is a Freetown city. This is a city, a real Freetown city. You can see, it's located near the ocean. You can see the ocean right there, at the far end. It's a big city. West Africa. So Makri decides now to go to Freetown in order to look for Oramis at her father's house. Because when Oramis escaped from her mother's house, they didn't manage to find her. I don't know what happened to how Amadou the hunter explained when he turned back to the village. I don't know what he explained to Makre. But Makre decided to go back because she knew that Orabis might have gone to her father in Freetown. So the only way to do was to go to Freetown and look for the girl. So Makre decides to go to Freetown to look for Orabis at her father's house. When she arrives at Jonas' house, Makre shouts Jonas to let her daughter go with her. She says, "I want to go with my daughter. Let my daughter go with me." But that was not accepted by Ade Jonas, that is Orabis' father, or the ex-husband of Makre. So Ade Jonas, Orabis' father, says he cannot let his daughter go with a responsible mother like Makre. First, she didn't take care of the child when she was in the village. Second, she forced her daughter to get married without even informing him. And therefore, she was a reckless mother like any other reckless mothers. And therefore, he was not ready to let his daughter to go with Makre to the village, because he knew exactly that when Orabis goes back to the village, then she could be circumcised. And therefore, Ade Jonas did not accept the offer, or did not accept what Makre said, or what Makre shouted, that I want to go with my daughter back to the village. She was not ready. Now the question here is, now what will happen? What will happen? Because the two are parents, that is Makre and Ade Jonas. Ade Jonas is the father, Makre is the mother. The mother wants to go with the daughter. The father wants to remain with his daughter. So how are they going to settle this misunderstanding? How are they going to settle it? We are going to see how the issue is going to be settled. So Makre tells Ade Jonas that she can argue no more with him, but her advocates will speak for her in the court of law. Ade Jonas promised to meet her in the court. And therefore, the issue had to be settled in the court, because there was no argument between the two separated couples, because they were no longer living together. Ade Jonas was living in Freetown in the city with another woman, Oya, while Makre lived in the village, because she was a primary school teacher, and she was married to another man known as Dauda. Therefore, everyone was married. That is, Ade Jonas on the other side had Oya, while Orabis' mother, Makre, was also married to Dauda. Ade Jonas asked Oya to speak for him as an advocate in the court. We can see here that Oya is a lawyer, he's an advocate, and therefore it was not difficult for Ade Jonas to hire Oya, because first of all, that was his wife, by the way, though it was not the official marriage, but they used to live together. It was not an official, they had not yet had the official marriage, but they used to live together. So Ade Jonas asked Oya to speak for him as an advocate in the court. So Oya takes time to teach Orabis few legal terms which are used by lawyers in the court. You know, the lawyers have got their own vocabularies. They have the so-called legal language, you know, full of legal terminologies. And sometimes when you go to the court, you cannot hear what they speak. Some of the words are very new. They can be very new to your ears. So Orabis learned fast the few rules and the questions that she would ask, or she would be asked during the case proceedings. Makre hires Salam Sese is her advocate. So the one who could speak on the side of Makre was this lawyer known as Salam Sese. So that was to speak for Macrae, or to, was supposed to speak on Macrae's camp, the camp of the camp of the Bono secret group, because Macrae was the member, was the member of the secret of the Bono secret group. So she gets a company of the Bono secret group who joined her in Freetown to witness the case. Now let us have a look at the first appearance in the court, the first day when they appeared in the court. My dear students, have you ever been to the court? Do you know the proceedings in the court? Do you know someone known as the judge or the magistrate? Do you know the advocates? Good. I hope you have ever come across, or you have maybe at one given time seen the court proceedings in your area. So what happened, the first appearance in the court, what happened in the first appearance in the court? Let us go together. On the first day of hearing the case, the Bono Women Trust demonstrated in Freetown streets with posters which were written different messages. But one of the notable messages was women's circumcision is mother's decision, according to the Temni people. That the decision of whether a girl should be circumcised or not rests in the hands of her mother, not the father, according to the Temni people. And therefore, Macrae is the one who had power or authority to let her daughter get circumcised or not. And that's why one of the posters was, women's circumcision is mother's decision. So the first day at the court, or the first appearance in the court, starts with the demonstration in the streets of Freetown. The Bono secret group, all the way from the village, came in big number, and they demonstrated in the streets. It means they opposed what was going on. They didn't want Orabis not to be circumcised. They wanted Orabis to be circumcised. And after all, it was like a punishment for what she did back in the village. You remember that Orabis fought those two girls who were known as women among the Temni, Rugiyat and Saleh, Yapose's daughters? I hope you remember. So on the first day of the hearing the case, the Bono women passed demonstrating in streets to pass a certain message to those who were in the streets. But later on, they went to the court. So the courtroom was filled with the Bono women. They were there. They escorted their fellow traditionalist, that is, they escorted Macrae. They didn't want her to be alone. They wanted to give her a company. They wanted her to feel that there are people who are supporting her. So they went together with her in the court. So in the court, almost a big number of people were in the court during that first appearance in the court, where the Bono women, they were there. They wanted to see the end of the game. So Judge Lansana Kanu is the one who was in charge of the case. Judge Lansana Kanu summoned the advocates and the witnesses and declared the court proceedings to begin or to start. And that is the court proceedings. You can see we have the advocates right there. We have the judge. As you can see, I can say maybe this is lawyer. And that one is Salam Sese. I'm just trying to make a connection with the novel. But my intention here is just to show you how the court looks like, the proceedings of the court, the way they get seated in the court. You can see you have the judges, advocates are there discussing. Another one is trying to explain something there, maybe defending someone. And there's another advocate seated there, a woman. I think you have the picture of how the proceedings in the court can be conducted. So the advocates and the witnesses were given chance to speak before the court one after another. And who had to start? Saram Sese. You remember this guy? Saram Sese, the advocate who represented Makre in the court. Saram Sese stood and asked a few questions to gather certain information which could help him in the final judgment of the case. Oya also got a chance to speak and was asked a few questions against Makre's lawyer. Orabis was also given a chance to speak and being asked a few questions by the advocates. When Saram Sese stood and cross-examined, this is a word which is used in the court, cross-examine, ask questions. When Saram Sese stood and cross-examined Orabis, it was revealed that Orabis was in sexual relationship with Abby at the age of 14. Ridiculous. At the age of 14, Orabis had already known boys. At the age of 14, my dear student, at the age of 14, Orabis had started engaging in love affairs with boys. And you remember Eddie? Eddie. Okay. So the advocate Saram Sese convinces the court that there is a need now for Orabis to be mutilated to reduce her sexual desire. Because mutilation of women or circumcision of women is done for the purpose of reducing their sexual desire. That a circumcised woman can be faithful to her husband. A circumcised girl can be faithful. She cannot engage in love affairs with boys until when she's married, until when she gets married. Now, advocate Saram Sese utilized that opportunity to convince the judge that there is a need for Orabis to be circumcised because it is shown that she started engaging love at the age of 14, and the reason behind why she has sexual desires is because she is not circumcised, according to the Tenni community. That a girl who is not circumcised can start engaging love because of having a higher desire of sexual intercourse. She can start engaging in sexual relations before a marriage. And therefore, circumcision was the only way that could make a girl to be faithful, a girl not engaging in love affairs. My dear students, do you agree with that? Okay, good. Let us proceed. So the advocate Saram Sese convinced the court that there is a need for Orabis to be circumcised or mutilated in order to reduce her sexual desire. Orabis feels disgraced and that before the court and thinks of committing suicide after the case. Because why she thinks of committing suicide, you know, Orabis kept this as a secret. She didn't want anyone to know whether she had started engaging in love affairs with boys. Even her father didn't know that she had a boy. She had a boyfriend known as Eddie. And therefore, by being revealed there in front of people, in public, in front of people, it was a disgrace. It was shame upon her hands. And therefore, having the secret revealed in front of people, she didn't find a reason why she should keep on living. She sort of committing suicide. She was really not ready, you know, she was not ready to keep on living with this sad news. You know, it's like she thought of what will happen. Because her father now knows that she's in love with boys. She's in love with a boy known as Eddie. And therefore, there is a high possibility that she can be punished. And it's obvious that she could be punished. Because first of all, she didn't expose it. Her father didn't know that she was engaged in love affairs. And therefore, she even sort of, you know, that she could just be buried alive, you know. It's very shame. You cannot tolerate such a situation to happen. You have your secret and then it is revealed in front of people. Shame upon your nose. So it's later known that Eddie revealed the secret of their relationship to Saram Sese. it came to be known that the one who revealed this secret was Eddie. So sometimes you can think that you have a secret, but the person that you are doing secret with, you are sharing secret with, sometimes can expose it. We call it in English, let the rat out of the bag. Let the rat out of the bag. That is revealing the secret for people to know what is going on. So the secret was revealed, and it was very unfortunate that it was revealed in front of people, including Adelionis, her father, was also there. So he knew that her daughter, Oramis, had already known boys, had already started engaging in love affairs. How could you do if you were you? Your secret being revealed in public, what could you do? Could you think of committing suicide? Ah, come on, guys. You should not think of committing suicide. You need to set down the problem. Committing suicide is not a solution. It cannot be a solution. The only issue to do is you have to know that the secret is revealed, and therefore you have to sit down with your father and then discuss that, I'm very sorry, my father, I did this, I didn't know the impact of this and this and this, and then the issue can be settled down. So the case was adjourned until next time, when whereby the judge in Samakano gave chance for both camps to prepare and come with more witnesses. Now, in the second appearance in the court, the second day, because the case was adjourned at the beginning, they appeared for the first time in the court, and then the case was adjourned until next time. So we're in the second day now. The second appearance in the court. On the second appearance in the court, Oya came accompanied with a gynecologist, Dr. Asiat Corona. My dear students, who is a gynecologist? Gynecologist. A gynecologist is someone, a doctor who is specialized, who is a specialist of women. A specialist of women affairs. Specialist of women is known as a gynecologist. So, Dr. Asiat Corona is a specialist. And we don't know why Dr. Asiat Corona is supposed to be there. I think there is something that there's something using that is going to be explained by Dr. Asiat Corona based on her profession. Based on her profession, being a doctor, being a specialist of women, I think she can tell us whether circumcision is necessary for women or for girls, or it's not necessary. What are the impacts of circumcision? I think you can get a lot of things concerning the merits and demerits of circumcision to girls. So the gynecologist explained the disadvantages of female genital mutilation. For example, that all those who are circumcised, circumcised girls always face difficulties during childbirth because they have that scar. During the time when they deliver, during deliverance, then the scar becomes a wound again. You know, it's like, because when we talk about mutilation, it's a total removal of the clitoris, and therefore partial or total removal of the clitoris. Therefore, during deliverance of the child, it's obvious that some problems can happen to a girl who is circumcised. And that's why the government is also against women's circumcision or female genital mutilation. So one of the disadvantages of women or girls' circumcision is the childbirth, difficulties during childbirth. But also there is another problem with women's circumcision, that is very easy to transmit sexual transmitted diseases, STDs, or like HIV/AIDS, you know, through unsterilized instruments. Or overbreeding. When there is overbreeding, it means someone develop anemia, you know, shortage of blood in the body, and sometimes can lead to death. And you know HIV/AIDS, that once you're a victim of HIV/AIDS, you know the consequences or the impacts which are brought by HIV/AIDS. So HIV/AIDS can be transmitted from one person to another, sometimes by sharing sharp objects like the instruments which are used for circumcision, especially the unsterilized instruments. And after all, we cannot talk of sterilized instruments during circumcision process. They cannot, the instruments are not sterilized. They are not sterilized. And therefore, there is a high possibility of transmitting diseases from one person to another person, or from one girl to another girl during the circumcision process. So overbreeding and transmission of diseases like HIV/AIDS and difficulties in childbirth are some of the disadvantages which are explained by Dr. Asiad Koroma, who is a specialist of women, a gynecologist. Oya, you remember Oya? This is Arionis's, can I say, fiancé? Because they are not officially married, they just live together. Oya was asked to finalize her defense, and they used that chance to convince the court that female genital mutilation is a bad, outdated cultural practice. She also established that Orabis had to decide on her own whether to be circumcised or not, because she was now grown up. At the age of 14, she could decide whether to be circumcised or not. So the decision of whether to be circumcised or not was in her hands. She went further by saying that Arionis has the right to live with his child or his daughter, since Mark did not show parental care and failed to protect her daughter against the circumcisions, that is, against the Bondo secret group. When Mark was given chance to speak, she concentrated on explaining the merits of circumcision to girls in her tribe. She explained the merits of circumcision or female genital mutilation among the Temne people. According to the Temne people, circumcision has a lot of merits or advantages, according to them. She says, circumcision for a girl is important as it reduces her sexual desire. A circumcised girl gets approval in her community and she becomes a real woman, according to the Temne people. As I explained it before, that a real woman among the Temne people was the one who was circumcised. Kiborka, the main big girl. And it was the word which meant an insult for someone who is not circumcised. So, according to Makre, it's very important for a girl to get circumcised in order to reduce her sexual desire. And in order for her to become a real woman, circumcision or female genital mutilation is unavoidable. When cross-examined by Oya as to why she got impregnated at the age of 14, she claims at the age of 14, while she claims to be circumcised, she becomes angry and fails to respond to the question. Let me tell you something about Makre. Makre was impregnated at the age of 14, and she gave birth at the age of 15 or 16. So she was still young, and she was impregnated out of wedlock. That is, she was not officially married. At the age of 14, it means she started engaging love affairs at the age of 13 or 12. Or at the age of 14, and then she got pregnant. Now the question is, did circumcision help her with anything to reduce her sexual desire? Because she said a circumcised girl cannot engage in love affairs, because once you get circumcised, your sexual desire will be reduced. So if she got pregnant at the age of 14, what's the use of circumcision? What's the use of circumcision? Why should a girl be circumcised? Why should a girl be circumcised? If the issue here is to reduce the sexual desire, but you can see here that Makre herself got pregnant at the age of 14. So it means circumcision or female genital mutilation has nothing to do with reduction of sexual desire. It has nothing to do with reducing the sexual desire of a girl. It's only the decision of someone. Someone can decide to be a herald or priesthood, and someone can decide to be sent off. So it has nothing to do with reducing the sexual desire. When Yakose was given chance to speak as a witness now, she also explained the advantages of women's circumcision. They just talk of the advantages. They don't talk anything about the disadvantages of demers of circumcision. Because according to their tradition, circumcision is very important. Any girl should be circumcised. All girls have to be circumcised. So they could not talk of the disadvantages of circumcision. They just talk of the positives of circumcision. According to Yakose, women's circumcision is important due to the following reasons. My dear students, let's go through the reasons given by Yakose as to why circumcision is very important for a girl. And then we can try to judge, we can weigh the points or the reasons given, whether they hold water or not. The first reason given by Yakose, the reader of the circumcisers, the Digba Sowe. Women's circumcision is the practice inherited from forefathers, and it has been practiced from generation to generation. So it's the practice which is inherited from one generation to another generation. And therefore, they could not abandon it because it was a must that they had to adapt the ways of their ancestors, the way the ancestors used to do. So Orabis, being a member of the Temni society, because her mother is a Temni by tribe, was supposed to be circumcised. The second reason given by Yakose is that a circumcised girl is a real and clean woman in the society regardless of her age. That is according to Yakose, that a girl who is circumcised becomes the a real woman, a clean woman, and she can be accepted as a woman regardless of her age. Whether she's 12, remember that lady, the one who was circumcised at the age of 12? I showed a picture right here. So the age didn't matter among the Temni people. To be called a woman depended much on whether you are circumcised or not. So a circumcised girl is a real and a clean woman in the society regardless of her age. A circumcised girl is taught another reason. A circumcised girl is taught how to become a good wife, since she gets trained on how to take care of a husband, knows how to cook palatable food, and how to take care of children. My dear students, those are the advantages or the reasons given by Yakose. That if you are not circumcised, it means you cannot take care of your husband if you get married. Is that true? I don't think. If you are not circumcised, you cannot be able to cook palatable food, sweet food, palatable food. You cannot. You cannot take care of the children. I don't think if these reasons hold water. It's only the pretext used by Yakose. To convince people that circumcision for girls is important, it's necessary, it's important for girls to be circumcised. Another reason given is that of women, circumcision reduces sexual desire for women, hence become faithful to their husband or to their husbands. Let us go back to Makri. She was a circumcised woman, but yet she changed husbands like shirts. She had Dauda, but before Dauda, maybe she had other husbands apart from Adonis, which is an indication of prostitution. You talk of reducing sexual desire. She was impregnated at the age of 14. She was impregnated at the age of 14. So this point does not hold water. We expect that being circumcised, she could not engage in sexual affairs at the age of 14. she could not get impregnated at that age. At least she could convince us that circumcision is important for orgasms in order to reduce their sexual desire. But yet, she doesn't convince us because of what happened to her when she was at the age of 14. So circumcision for girls cannot reduce the sexual desire. It's only the myth which has been carried from one generation to another generation. Having heard from all the witnesses and the advocates, the judge Lasana Khan took some time to pass through the evidences and explanations which were given, and then came out with the following ruling. The judgment was as follows. First, Oramis is a grown-up, hence she can decide on whether to be circumcised or not. There is no one who can force her to be circumcised without. Having heard from all witnesses and advocates, the judge Lasana Khan took some time to pass through the evidences and explanations which were given out with the following ruling. So the final judgment from Judge Lasana Khan was as follows. First, Aribonis has the right to live with his daughter since Macri could not protect her against the Bondo women. Therefore, the judge Lasana Khan dismissed the case and Aribonis won the case. The Bondo women left the court quietly through the back door. Oya, Aribonis and Oramis embraced each other for victory against their rival Macri. A few weeks later, Aribonis and Oya got married. As I said before, they are not officially married. So after winning the case now, they decided to get married officially. So a big marriage ceremony was conducted, and Oramis witnessed the journalists taking photos to appear on the front pages of the newspaper, and the event was broadcast live on the national television. When Aribonis was asked to kiss her wife Oya, he drew closer, embraced her, and had a long kiss. Oramis buried her face on her palms and laughed, a sign of feeling shy. And that is the wedding ceremony between Aribonis and Oya the advocate. As you can see, they are celebrating because they won the case, and Oramis now had to remain in the hands of Aribonis and Oya. And on the other side, the Bondo Secret Group had to leave back the village empty-handed. It means they didn't go back with Oramis as how they expected it could be. And that marks the end of our story concerning an answered in class. The story of Oramis, a town girl from Freetown, who went to the village and was forced to be circumcised. But at the end of the day, we see that she wins in the case and she remains in the hands of her father, Ade Jones. My dear students, I hope you enjoyed this story, and I'm sure that you have understood what it means by an answer in class. One of the famous books that you're going to use it to answer different questions, especially the ones which touch about the issues of African traditions and customs. It can answer really a good number of questions which relate to African customs and traditions. And now, my dear students, let me end up here for today. Our lesson ends there. Next time when we meet, we'll proceed on with characterization, whereby the characters will be explained or given brief explanation concerning the characters, and if possible, if time allows, we can proceed on the thematic analysis of the novel an answer day class by Osman Conte. So let me mark the end of the lesson by saying, take care of Corona, take care of COVID-19, wash your hands with gushing water, observe distance, and stay at home. Bye.